Live steel weapons are made for one purpose. Killing you. Don't do this at home. You'll get killed.
We're what you call professionals.
Kyle Potts. In the Society for Creative Anachronism, I'm known as Captain Cecil Torleone, and this is the Brotherhood. Today we're going to be doing some cut tests to understand how some of the medieval weapons that we practice and train with would really operate. In order to do so, we have gathered a variety of weapons that we'll be discussing, the pros and cons of them. My background in history is that I have a bachelor's in medieval history, and I've studied martial arts for a long time, including SCA for the last 8 years or so. For the event that we're hosting, the Nine Worthies, a test of arrow and steel, this is going to be one aspect of many parts of our event that will pull it together to have a more cohesive, immersive SCA event. So I'm going to talk about the weapons that we've brought out for the cut tests. We're going to go over some of the strengths and weaknesses and discuss the time periods where the weapons were used. We'll start with this thing right here. This is an Albion Reeve. It's a Type 10 oakshot sword. These types of swords would have seen use from the Viking era onward until about the First Crusade. This type of blade is very, very strike-oriented. This is the type of blade you chop and you strike with. It has a very, very wide thrusting tip, which gives it a lot less piercing than you'd see on some of the other weapons, for example, the Shamshir that we'll get to. This weapon is about as well designed for a strike as you could possibly get. This weapon is a hand and a half greatsword. It's a Type 12A oakshot. And you would have seen this kind used in both Italy and Germany. This weapon has enough hand so you can grip it with the other side, and you can go through your motions and do more powerful strikes. This is the kind of weapon that started developing as armor got to be more protective and defensive, and this type of weapon is very, very strongly oriented for strikes, though it does have a thrusting tip that it can utilize more effectively than the earlier versions of swords, the 10 and the 11. This sword is the cold steel hand and a half. This weapon is a oakshot 18 on the typology, though arguably a 14, depends on who you ask. It is a much thinner thrusting tip than our type 12 that we looked at, and it has a diamond-shaped fuller throughout the length of the blade. This type of sword would be very, very well orchestrated for a two-handed strike to an opponent, and it feels very good when you do that. This is a Roman gladius. It would have been used in the Roman Empire era and to the fall of the Roman Empire. This weapon, when you feel it, it's incredibly short and much, much wider. This weapon was really designed for a strike, short chopping motions. It also has a very, very pronounced thrusting tip, which also is ideal for thrusting, though this is the type of weapon that the Romans could mass produce for their infantry and for their cavalry officers, and after mass producing them, put them out there and everyone could get one. This type of sword is a Shamshir, made by cold steel. You'll note that it has a curved blade used primarily from horseback and was very strike-oriented, though it has a very, very severe tip. These weapons are very light and longer than you'll note the Type 10 is, by a few inches, and that's because from horseback you'd need an extended reach, was used primarily by Turks and by different Arab tribes, such as the Berbers. Over here, we have the cold steel warhammer. This thing is incredibly mean. You would start to see these used towards the 14th to 15th centuries, again to pierce armor as armor got more and more protective. It has both a hammer side and a raven's beak, a pointed, sharp, piercing point to get through helmets and plate armor. These things are incredibly brutal, as you'll see when we start doing the tests. Next, we have another cold steel weapon. This is a cold steel poleaxe. The cold steel poleaxe stands at about 6 feet tall and can be used from both sides. On one end is essentially an axe head used for chopping, striking. And on the back end, there is a pointed hammer end that would be used for bludgeoning through armor. This weapon was used in two hands and started to see lots of use towards the end of the 14th century, beginning of the 15th century, and became very famous for different pikemen groups, particularly the Swedes and the Swiss, and different mercenary groups. But this was the weapon that eventually got rid of cavalry, that proved to be the counter to cavalry that Europeans have been looking for. And then over here, we see the cold steel boar spear. This boar spear would have been designed for hunting. That's what the prongs are for. So if you were to strike a boar, the boar couldn't get past or get through. It would stop the creature there. Though people have been using spears for as long as humans have been fighting with weapons. It's one of the oldest designs. It gives you an extra reach. And this is the kind of weapon that in the Middle Ages would have been used by both mercenary groups that are trained for it and also by peasant levies and militia troops because of the ability and ease of purchasing them, creating them, and outfitting mass amounts of troops with them. You could use this weapon both for a strike and both for the thrust. Practice the SDA wrap shot, which is striking with the back edge of a sharpened blade.
Yeah!
There you go. See, that was beautiful. Ooh.
Yeah!
Well, the reason that we do cut tests are actually twofold. One, it's incredibly fun. But it is also very educational. In the SCA, we fight with rattan weapons, and there's a reason for that. We don't want to kill each other. But fighting with rattan, while a viable analog for a real steel sword, still does not give you the feel and the accuracy of a real steel sword. When using a sword, there are things that work and things that don't. And that translates back into fighting, showing you why a certain technique may or may not work.